The presentation of the IoT T-Stick M5 in video number 41 has created a lot of interest and positive feedback. And while I'm waiting for the latest revision of the Blue Hat PC board, I thought it's time to get started on some sort of instructional videos to give you some insights how the whole thing works. Yes, there will be a user manual as well, but for many people, including myself, videos are just more convenient. Today, I would like to show you how to configure the IoT T-Stick and get it ready for your application. So, welcome to the Internet of Toy Trains, I am Hans Tanner. The IoT T-Stick ships with the IoT T software installed and ready to go. All you need to do is configuring it for your application by selecting the communication interface and the function head. And all configurations can be done using a smartphone or a PC web browser with human-readable menus. There is no need for going through tables with cryptic numbers and then pick exactly the wrong value. To get started, take the IoT T-Stick out of the box and connect it to a USB power source using the provided USB cable. This connection is only used to supply power, so there is no need to connect it to a computer. A simple phone charger will do the trick as well. As soon as power is applied, the IoT T-Stick is starting up automatically and shows its status on the display. By default, it is configured to connect to your Wi-Fi access point. However, since out of the box no router is configured, it enters the Wi-Fi setup and connect mode. You can now use your smartphone and connect it to the access point indicated in the display. Once connected, the smartphone should automatically bring up the configuration screen, where you can select the router of your Wi-Fi and enter the network password. Click Save and the IoT T-Stick will connect to your network and show the assigned IP address in the display. The access credentials are saved and will be reused next time to automatically connect to the network after power-up. If the IoT T-Stick is unable to connect to your Wi-Fi, or if there is no attempt to enter the Wi-Fi credentials for longer than 2 minutes, the IoT T-Stick will create an access point on its own and display the access data. You now can connect to it using your computer or smartphone and use a web browser to access the configuration pages. In both modes, station mode and access point mode, the Wi-Fi will time out and shut down after sitting idle for a while. In station mode, this is after 2 minutes, in access point mode, after 3 minutes. However, it will not time out and shut down as long as a web browser is connected to it. And of course, it will also not time out if Wi-Fi is used for normal operation, for example, when receiving commands over MQTT or when acting as a gateway. In these cases, the Wi-Fi connection will remain active also when no browser is connected. If the Wi-Fi connection is shut down, the status is shown in the display. As soon as you click the B button, the IoT T-Stick will either reconnect to your Wi-Fi or restart its own access point, depending on the previously active Wi-Fi mode. Once the stick is up and running and the Wi-Fi access cycle is completed, you can use the main button to cycle through the display pages. As explained before, page 1 shows the Wi-Fi status, either connected to your Wi-Fi, providing an access point, or disconnected. Page 2 shows the device setup, starting with selected communication mode and head device. Then it shows the activated logic modules, if any, and the gateway activation status. Page 3 shows the IoT T-Stick device status. Here you can see voltage and amperage of the USB power supply, the battery, and more. It also displays the working temperature of the ESP32. Depending on selected head and communication mode, stick temperatures of up to about 55 degrees Celsius are normal, particularly if Wi-Fi is active, For example, when the device is constantly communicating via MQTT. Page 4 provides a viewer screen depending on the selected communication interface. If you are using the LocalNet interface, you see the LocalNet commands that are received, the latest always in the top line. Note that for some longer commands, the display line is not wide enough, so you see only the first few bytes. When the DCC interface is selected, you see the decoded DCC commands that come along the track. There are actually two separate screens, one for cyclical commands and the other for one-time commands. Cyclical commands are the refresh commands for locomotives. As they are sent out several times per second, displaying them in real time would be somewhat hectic. Therefore, the IoTT stick is only watching for changes in the cyclical commands and updates the display if there is any speed, direction or function change. Also here, the display is not wide enough and the content limited. Now click the B button to toggle between cyclical and one-time view. In one-time view, you see switch and signal commands decoded in real-time, again the latest in the top line. And as those commands are short, you get the full information. Clicking the main button again brings you back to page 1 of the display. To set or change the configuration of the IoTT stick, you can use a web browser either on your smartphone or on a PC. If the IoTT stick is connected to your Wi-Fi network, you simply type the IP address that is displayed on the stick into your browser and the first configuration page is loaded. If the stick provides its own access point, you first have to connect your PC or smartphone to the stick and then load the indicated web page. In both cases, you will be presented with the node configuration page, which is used to set the basic work mode and select embedded logic modules. In the first section, you select the communication module and the hat. For example, if you want to use the Blue Box hat and feed it with commands directly from the track power, you select DCC and Blue Hat. If you prefer to receive the commands directly from LocalNet, you can connect the LocalNet interface to the Grove port and select LocalNet. If you select a LocalNet-based option, the BushBeBit checkbox will appear. Check it if you want the IoTT stick to emulate the behavior of a Digitrax command station when the BushBeBit is set. If you are not familiar with this powerful option, check the link in the description below. The Embedded Logic Module section lets you activate the IoTT stick's built-in logic modules. Right now, the only option is the button handler, which is used to translate button activity into commands for signals, switches, and more. It will be described in a separate video. Also, there will be more embedded logic modules released in the future, so it is a good idea to subscribe to the channel and hit that bell icon so you will be in a premium seat when new features become available. The remaining options on the node configuration page are used to define the Wi-Fi access. Define the node name to be used for this access point and whether to include the MAC address of the device into the node name to make it unique. This option is useful when you have several sticks providing access points at the same time. The most important selection is whether the stick should connect to your Wi-Fi network or provide an access point on its own. If you set the stick to connect to your Wi-Fi, you can also specify whether it should use a static or dynamic IP. If you don't care or you don't know what that means, select Dynamic. Furthermore, you can specify whether the stick should get the actual time from an internet time server. You can specify an NTP server for your region and specify the time zone settings. Normally, it is best to use a server pool to avoid problems with server downtime. I leave you links for more information on servers and time zone settings in the description below. If you select Device AP, you will get data fields to specify the access point name and IP it will be using. Note that if you use the Device AP, you will no longer be able to select MQTT or Gateway as command sources, as these options require an active Wi-Fi connection to access the MQTT server. At the end of the page, you have four buttons. Click Save and Restart to make your changes permanent. The web page will write the data to the IoTT stick and then reboot the stick to come up with the new options. Click Cancel to disregard all changes and restore all data fields to the current settings. Save to File lets you download the current stick settings and store them to a file on your computer. Should your stick ever lose the configuration settings, you can simply use the Load from File button, pick the saved information and reload it to the stick. Note that the Save to File button downloads the entire configuration, including HAT and embedded module settings, not only the information set on the configuration page. When you save and restart the stick, you may see that some of the menu entries in the top line are changing. For example, if you switch from DCC to Loconet as command source, the DCC Viewer tab will change to Loconet Viewer. Other page tabs may appear or disappear as well, so the web pages always reflect the current configuration of the stick to make configuration as simple as possible. Finally, let's have a quick look at the Loconet and DCC Viewer pages. The Loconet Viewer is a simple list showing the incoming messages very similar to the display on the stick. However, as there is more room, you will always see the entire message beginning with the already decoded opcode. With that information, it is very easy to look it up in the Loconet PE document, if needed. You also can use the stop button to pause the display. Note that contrary to the IoTT stick, the newest message is added at the bottom. The DCC viewer shows the incoming messages grouped into cyclical and one-time messages. Again, as there is more room on the PC screen, the cyclical messages are shown one message per line. The one-time messages are displayed as they are coming over the track. If you change the speed or direction of a locomotive, you will see some changes in the cyclical screen. Note that it is possible that you see different speed messages for the same locomotive while you are changing the speed settings. This is because the stick waits a few milliseconds before it determines that the particular command is no longer refreshed. During this time, it may show up with two different values, but the previous command will then disappear. Overall, I think having real-time viewers for Loconet and DCC is very useful for debugging, as it makes it easy to verify that commands are indeed coming along the network or track. When done, there are two ways to power down the stick. You can press the power button for 6 seconds, and the stick will switch off. Or, much simpler, you just pull the power plug. In this case, the stick keeps running for another 30 seconds and shuts down if power is not coming back. And that's it for this video. I hope this information was useful or at least interesting for you. If so, please click the like button below. Doing so does not only help my ego, but also helps to promote this video and the IoTT channel in general, because the YouTube algorithm likes the likes. Thanks for watching and see you next time.